Day 30 of the most extreme 30-day challenge that I've ever put myself through. It's been 30 days of every single day rising out of bed at 4 a.m., watching no TV, no masturbation, no alcohol, just pushing myself to the extreme. And I know this may sound absolutely crazy, I get it. The reason, if you would have told me I was doing this 32 days ago, I would have thought you were crazy. This is something that I decided to do 31 days ago, and the next day, I decided to do it. And before I jump into the topic of this video, I think that brings up a really important point. Because a lot of times when we get an idea, or we get in a goal or something like that, what we want to do, something I learned from Tony Robbins is that you have to take action on it immediately. The absolute worst thing that you can do if you have a goal or anything like that is to not take action on it immediately. Because what happens is there will be this period that goes by where you will think yourself out of doing it. If all of a sudden, you know, you say, you know what, that sounds like a great idea, George, and I'm gonna do this, but I'm gonna wait until the first of next month, you know what's gonna happen? During that time period, you will think yourself out of doing it. That's just how our brain works. And so Tony Robbins, what he says, if you have a goal or an idea or something like that, in fact, you are actually better off not even getting the goal or anything like that in your head or writing it down until you are ready to take action immediately. If you have a goal to, you know, make 100 sales calls this week, and it's Sunday at like, you know, 10 o'clock at night, if you write that down, you better make that first phone call right then and there. Even if it's just one call, you better call someone in California on the other, you know, time zone. You better figure out a way to take action on it immediately, because the longer you go without taking action on your idea or your goal, the longer, the bigger of a chance you have of talking yourself out of it. And so with that being said, the reason why I decided to do this is because we live in a day and age where there is no consequence for being lazy. We live in a very safe world. And you know, hey, which is a good thing, right? Because it's safe for, you know, everybody and our kids and our families and so forth. You can get by in life being totally lazy, just getting high and drunk all day and eating junk food and sitting on the couch watching TV. And there's no consequence for that. And in fact, not only is there no consequence for it, you can in fact be rewarded for that kind of lifestyle. I mean, you can get food stamps and welfare and this and that, and all kinds of handouts just for being lazy. Where if you were alive a long time ago, you know, thousands of years ago and so forth, that was a different story. You know, if you were lazy, then you would get eaten by, you know, like a lion or a tiger or a bear or something, or a tribe would come and overtake your tribe and, you know, rape your family and your kids and everything. And so you could not afford to be lazy. You constantly had to be pushing yourself. And so with that being said, because we live in such a safe day and age, we have to take it into our own hands to put evolutionary pressure upon ourselves. And that's why I like to do these, you know, extreme types of challenges like this. Anybody that knows me knows that I'm obsessed with 30-day challenges where I push myself to do crazy things. And interestingly enough, one of the greatest discoveries that I've ever made in my life has come due to the fact that I've always been a journaler. For some reason, since I was like in elementary school, I've always kept a journaler. I've always been an avid journaler. And so because of that, I can look back over my life and I can start to see patterns. I can read through them and start to notice correlations and things like that. And one of the greatest discoveries that I've ever made in my life is about feeling happy and fulfilled. And I have noticed throughout my own patterns in life that the times that I am the most happiest and excited and just energetic about life is when I am actively pushing myself towards a very challenging goal. A goal that is really stretching me, but is just within reach so that I know that I can achieve it. Not that it's out of reach and I know I can't do it, but something that really is pushing me, stressing me in a good way, but actively moving towards something. And on the opposite end, I've noticed that I've been the least happiest, the least fulfilled, and most depressed and things like that is when I don't have a lot going on. You know, when I'm not really working towards anything. And so there is a, you know, if you are not happy with your life and the way things are going, do something radical. It doesn't have to be what I just did, but do something radical to make an extreme challenge and a change in your life. And so why wake up at 4 a.m.? You know, I wrote down a list of all the different CEOs and incredible people that wake up at 4 a.m. because it wasn't that long ago that that I came across an article and it was about all the most incredible people and how early they wake up, and they wake up ridiculously early. And it's always been said that success leaves clues. It does. And there was tons of, I mean, just amazing human beings that all wake up ridiculously early. And this was just some of them. The CEO of Chrysler, Sergio Marchionne, he wakes up at 3:30 in the morning. The Virgin America CEO, David Krush, wakes up and starts working by 4:15 a.m. Starbucks CEO, Howard Schultz, wakes up at 4:30 a.m. and is in the office by 6 a.m. Twitter and Square CEO, Jack Dorsey, wakes up in the dark and has ran 6 miles before dawn. Next desk director, Dan Lee, starts his day at 3:30 in the morning. Michelle Obama is working out by 4:30 in the morning. Apple CEO Tim Cook wakes up at 3:45 a.m. and gets a head start in the day. And there were so many. I mean, if I would literally be going all day if I was to read you all the different people. But why is that? I mean, why is it that all these people get up so early in the morning? I mean, I've already achieved success. They don't have to. And well, the reason why is because successful people know that our most valuable commodity in this life is time. The one thing we all have in common is 24 hours. And successful people know if they want to get the highest return on their investment of time, then they have to maximize every single minute of their day. You know, a lot of people go through life looking for the magic clue, the magic bullet to become successful, when really what it just boils down to is just a matter of productivity, just a matter of getting the most amount of done with the time, a lot of time that we do have. And that's why successful people get up so early, is because they know that that'll give them just a little bit more of that very precious commodity, time. So time is our most valuable commodity. Another great reason for waking up early is that it's a distraction-free zone. You know, when I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, I mean, the world hasn't even woke up yet. And, you know, it's like all throughout the day, I have 3 businesses, social media that's blowing up and everything like that. I'm constantly getting inundated with text messages, with emails, with phone calls, with notifications from every single social media platform in the world. And this is that one time of the day when I know that I'm not gonna be overwhelmed with all that stuff. And in fact, what I've done to help me out is that by the time when I go to sleep, I put my phone in airplane mode until I'm done with my morning routine in the morning, so that, you know, I don't get interrupted, because there are some people that are up at 4 a.m. just because they've been partying all night and so forth. So I like to keep my phone on airplane mode. That's a great tip. Another great benefit to waking up really early in the morning, like 4 a.m., is it's a psychological win. So if you've ever read Brian Tracy's book, Eat That Frog, he talks about how one of the best things that you can do is to eat the frog first thing in the morning. And the reason why is because willpower is like a muscle. We only have so much of it. You know, and as the day goes on, you have the most willpower in the morning, and as the day goes on, it gets depleted. That's why you're more likely to take a shot or drink alcohol or something later on in the day, because you're versus right in the morning. Because your willpower is strongest in the morning and it's weakest as the day goes on. So if you can set yourself up for a psychological win first thing in the morning, like getting up right in the morning, really early in the morning, and just getting a head start on your day, you're going to set yourself up for a great psychological win. You'll have eaten that frog. You'll build those willpower muscles. And so how to wake up early? I want to give you a couple of tips on how to wake up early, because, you know, hey, it does take a little bit of training to do this. But the best advice that I can really give you about this is to change your perception, to change your belief structure about this. You know, a lot of people are probably watching this saying, oh my gosh, George, you are insane. You know, waking up at 4 a.m., what's next? You're gonna get up at 3 a.m., you're gonna get up at 2 a.m., why not just not go to sleep at all? You know, that's their belief structure. Well, listen, you know, when you change the way that you look at the world changes. So instead of seeing getting up at 4 a.m., as something torturous, look at it, flip it around, and look at it as the tremendous amount of benefits that you can receive. Imagine, say right now you get up at 7 o'clock in the morning. Maybe you're sleeping later than that, whatever. So you get up at 6 a.m. Say you get up at 5 a.m. and you decide to getting up at 4 a.m. That extra hour, what could you do with that? You could build a website over the course of a month. You could, you know, blog every single day. You could start a YouTube channel. You could do whatever. You could hit the gym, you could study, you could learn a new language, you could learn an instrument, so many things you could do. And then at the same time, that'll kind of force you to go to bed earlier as well, so you'll make better choices. You'll feel better. Imagine waking up in the morning having more energy. I find getting up early in the morning, I have more energy. That it's, I'm quite the opposite. I have a tremendous amount of energy. So when you start to reframe the way you look at it as something difficult to something beautiful, then it's gonna get easier. Imagine, just imagine this, instead of going out on Friday night, getting drunk, drinking alcohol, eating a bunch of junk food, that you went to sleep early, like 9, 10 o'clock, you got up next morning, Saturday morning and Sunday morning at 4 a.m. Just imagine that. The whole world is sleeping. They're not even gonna be awake, you know, for another 6 hours, probably till like 10 o'clock. And, you know, you've gone for a bike ride, you've done yoga, you've read like, you know, half of a book practically, you've wrote in your blog, in your journal, you've done all these incredible things. Imagine waking up feeling like that, having that head start on the day, on the week, when everybody else is sleeping. Imagine feeling like that, right? Instead of waking up feeling like junk, your face is all bloated, you ate all this junk food last night. Just imagine that. And so when you start to change the perception and your belief structure about what you're doing, then it just becomes naturally easier. Another quick tip on how to wake up earlier is to program into your mind how you want to feel when you wake up in the morning before you even wake up. So when I go to bed at night, the last 5 minutes of my day is the most important part of my day. That's when I tell myself, you know what, when I wake up tomorrow morning, I'm gonna jump out of bed and say today is gonna be a great day. I'm gonna feel so energetic, I'm gonna feel alive, I'm gonna feel excited, tomorrow's gonna be phenomenal. You know, on the opposite end, most people that go to bed and say, oh my God, I gotta get up tomorrow morning, oh, I gotta get up, so go to work. And then they wake up in the morning, oh my God, you know, oh, it's so early, let me hit the snooze button like 87 times. Or imagine if you woke up in the morning and you said, oh my God, it's another day, I'm so excited. And so when you go to bed, program into your mind ahead of time how you wanna feel so that all night long your mind can marinate on that feeling and you can wake up living that experience. Nutrition has to be on point. You know, when you're doing this, one of the most interesting things that I've learned about this experiment is just how sensitive we are to our diet and our nutrition and things like that. So what do I mean by that? So for example, when I first started doing this, like, you know, everything was going great and I was doing it, and all of a sudden I eat really clean throughout the weekdays, and on the weekends, that'll tend to be the time that, you know, if I cheat a little bit more on the weekend. And so I remember, you know, it was like the first week, and all of a sudden, I was eating like, you know, really like paleolithic and everything, and really clean, everything was perfect. And my daughter, she was spending the night at my house, and I got up 4 a.m., did my whole workout, my morning routine and everything before she even woke up in the morning. And I remember I was feeling so incredible. I remember just feeling so energetic. And we went out, you know, to this organic, gluten-free restaurant. We had breakfast, and I just remember feeling like, wow, this is so incredible. You know, I'm not even getting a lot of sleep, but I still just feel magnificent. This is so, like, this is so amazing. I rode her on the bike 7 miles over to my parents' house, and all of a sudden, you know, they busted up the chips. We started having tortilla chips and things like that, and we went and got Mexican food. And the next thing you know, I just remember feeling like this wave of fatigue come on over me. And it lasted all the way until the next day. And what I came to realize is that it was what all of a sudden I put in my body. That because of the fact that, I mean, every single day throughout this experiment, I have gotten about 4 to 6 hours of sleep. I mean, I don't think there's even been one day where I got more than 7 hours of sleep. Maybe like one day a week, I would get like 7 hours of sleep. But, you know, the majority of the time, it'd be like 4 to 6 hours of sleep every single night. And so when you're doing that, your nutrition, your diet has to be on point. And that's something I really realized, just how sensitive that my body is to, you know, foods and things like that. Because as soon as I had those chips and the Mexican food and everything, all of a sudden the fatigue hit me. Where the next day after that, what I did was I did a cleanse, I fasted everything out of me, and boom, I was back to my energetic, normal self again. And so I realized that, you know, if I'm going to play this game of waking up this early in the morning, then I need to be really sensitive to what I'm putting in my body. So if you're going to do something like this, understand that your nutrition has to be on point. Your diet has to be on point, because that's going to play a huge toll on how you feel waking up in the morning, your energy levels. And that's also, you know, a big reason why I didn't drink throughout this 30-day period. You know, because really you can't. If you're getting up at 4 a.m. in the morning, how are you going to drink alcohol, right? I mean, you can't. If you drink alcohol and you're getting so little sleep, it's just going to be disastrous. So by default, I really couldn't, but I didn't anyways. And not drinking the alcohol and stuff like that on its own, I mean, the fat just melted off. I lost 10 pounds this 30 days without even trying, put on muscle, everything. So that in itself was, you know, a really extra, really cool benefit. Now, Now I want to talk to you a little bit about the pitfalls and obstacles and what to really expect going into this type of challenge. The most challenging part of doing this type of thing, like getting up early, like 4 a.m. or 5 a.m. or whenever you want to get up, is going to come from the obstacles, the events all of a sudden that miraculously pop up. Like I had Cinco de Mayo, everybody was going out Cinco de Mayo. I couldn't because I had to get up early. There was parties or events, weddings, all different kinds of things. I had events with my daughter and things like that. We were out at a baseball game on Saturday night. I was up late. You may be going out, different things, but you still have to commit to getting up early. And in my opinion, one of the biggest challenges you're going to face is going to come from the pressure of others, the obstacles of others, because other people may not understand why you are doing this. And, say for example, you go on a date or you're hanging out with friends or something like that. You're wanting to go to bed early, go in early and go to bed early so you can wake up early. They may not understand that. And a lot of times your success will make other people feel uncomfortable because it kind of like hits them in the side, pointing out an area that may be a point of weakness for them. And so naturally, for people to feel better, they tend to want to put you down and things like that. You have to love them in spite of themselves. They don't really mean that they're doing that, but just know that that is something that, in my opinion, is one of the biggest challenges. It comes from the other people that are not going to understand why you're doing this. They're going to say you're crazy, you're ludicrous, and so forth. And as you're going into doing something like this, like getting up at 4 a.m., getting up at 5 a.m., or whatever time you want to start getting up, understand that there is the four phases of identity transformation that you're going to go through. Some of you guys have been following me for a while. You may be familiar with one of my famous videos, the identity change, my motivational video that I did that talks about in depth about the four phases of identity transformation. And this doesn't matter what you're doing in life. We all go through this, and this is the same, and I knew this. I had this mentally prepared in my head going into this 30-day challenge that this I was going to go through this. And so if you can have this in your head ahead of time and going into some kind of 30-day challenge or whatever you're going to do, then it's going to give you a head start because you'll know what to expect. And so this is it. Number one, the first phase of identity change and identity transformation is what's called inception. And that's when in the beginning, everything is exciting. You just get into a brand new relationship. You start a new diet. You start a new workout program. You start a new job and everything is just amazing. You're so excited and you're picturing all the success you're going to have, the ripped body, all the money you're going to make, everything. And all of a sudden what happens, the next phase is what's called deception. This is phase two. This is when every single fiber of your existence is going to try to get you to quit. It's going to try to get you to go back to your old lifestyle, that of which is familiar. Because the only thing that our brain cares about is keeping us in a familiar state, keeping us safe. Because if you look back in time, when we were our ancestors, change wasn't always safe. To go into an unknown woods was not safe, but living in the village you'd always lived in was safe. Maybe going to those woods, you get eaten by a bear. Maybe you eat these berries over here and you die. You saw this other, guy eat that mushroom or that berry and he died. And so anytime and so our brain is built to, is the same brain from our ancestors. And so we have to know that our brain just cares about keeping us safe and in that familiar zone. So stage two is what's called deception. And I want to take an extra minute to talk about this stage because it is so important. And this really is what crushes 95% of everybody when they're moving towards a goal. They hit this stage of deception. And all of a sudden, they're like, oh my gosh, you know what? I just can't do this. You start to feel emotional. Your body and your mind will actually play tricks on you. What happened to me? In the first week, it was really exciting and everything like that doing this. I was like, oh my God, I was through the roof, energy. I was getting up at 4 a.m., all these other crazy things. And all of a sudden, what happened in week two? In about week two, all of us, and I knew that this was coming. I knew, I said, this is going to come somewhere because it always does. You don't skip the deception phase. All of a sudden, I remember waking up and feeling a little symptoms of like a cold and like a sickness. And I don't get sick. And in fact, I don't even believe in getting sick. It just doesn't happen to me. It's not a situation that I require or I believe in. I don't believe in the flu. I know some of you guys watch this like, what? How do you not believe in the flu and sickness and all that? That's crazy. Whatever. I just, I don't believe in Santa Claus and the Tooth Fairy and things like that. I stopped believing at that in a certain age. I decided a couple years ago, I decided that I no longer believe in the flu, that I don't believe in getting sick, and I don't get sick anymore. I don't get even a tiniest symptom of a cold, no matter how hard I push myself, no matter how little sleep I get, no matter how many people I'm exposed to, how much I'm traveled, I just don't get sick. It's just not something I believe in. And, you know, hey, and I know if you're saying, well, that's not right. You know, the flu exists. Well, you get the flu, you experience it for me. If the flu ever even thinks about coming around, I'll send it your way. So you can have it for me. But I just don't believe in it. It's my choice. Dr. Wayne Dyer, someone who who was a mentor of mine, rest in peace, he adopted that philosophy as well. That's something actually I learned from him, is that he just decided, he made a decision that he just didn't believe in it. And he didn't require getting sick, the flu and sickness and things like that, and he never got sick. So I just said, hey, okay, well, I don't believe in it anymore either. I don't think it exists, and I don't get sick. So all of a sudden, I started to feel these symptoms of getting sick, just a little bit. And so I knew that this was deception. I said, this is stage two deception trying to play with me, but it's not going to get me. So I went right up to the mirror, and I just said, you know, nice try, you know. You better get out of my body. Whatever you think you are, I don't even believe in you. You don't even exist. And, you know, I'm warning you right now, you're gone, because my white blood cells are going to destroy you, okay? You're better off going somewhere else, because in here, the white blood cells are already building you a gravestone in a cemetery. You don't have a chance to survive in here. And in fact, I'm going to go to the gym and I'm going to crush it even 10 times harder right now, just to prove to you I don't believe in you. You don't exist. You're not real to me. Get out of here. And I did that, and I psyched myself out, and boom, it was gone like that. Within, you know, a day, whatever thought it had a chance of messing with me was gone. I ripped it right out of my system, because I knew it wasn't real. I knew it was that deception part of my brain trying to trick me to say, hey, George, sleep in. You know, you don't need all this BS, you know, you're pushing yourself, you know, go back to your old lifestyle, blah, blah, blah. And I said, no, you know what? No way. I'm following through this. Screw you. I'm continuing on. So after you go through deception, the next phase is what is called transformation. And this is when it becomes to become a part of you. It's not that hard anymore. You're starting to build the habits and things like that. You become what's called consciously competent. You realize, hey, you know what? I'm starting to lose some weight. You're starting to get a little bit easier getting up before. Okay, all right, I'm getting the hang of this. And the last phase is what's called identity. This is when it just literally just becomes your identity. It just becomes who you are. You don't even have to think about it anymore. I'm not sure if I've quite hit the identity stage yet, because I've only done this for 30 days. I'm probably still in the transformation phase. Identity would probably be if I did this every day for a year. Then that's probably when, you know, I wouldn't have to think about it. It's like no matter what, you know, just it's like a tattoo on me. I just get up at 4 a.m. That's when they call it unconsciously competent, where you just don't even have to think about it anymore. It's just, you know, who you are. And we're all consciously competent in things. You know, maybe it's just your identity, you know, to smoke cigarettes. And you didn't even realize you smoked 3 cigarettes when you did, but it's just your identity. So the key is to change your identity into what you want it to be. And just a quick last tip on that deception thing is that when you get to that phase, you want to celebrate it. You do want to celebrate it. Like when I got there, I was excited. I said, yes, I'm in stage two. Good. That means I'm moving through the process. Because the quicker you get to stage two deception and you move fast through that, the quicker you'll move into transformation and the fourth phase, which is identity. So you want to move into that really quickly. And so some of the benefits that I've received from doing this challenge, I have experienced a record-breaking month in business. And over the past 30 days, I've crushed it. And I don't really know why that happens. For those of you that have been following me, you'll remember I actually did this, but at 5 a.m. I got up every single day for 30 days at 5 a.m. I did this, how long ago was it ago? Like 8 months ago or something like that, I did it. And I remember at the end of it, I said, you know, it's been a record-breaking month in business. I can't believe it. I run 3 businesses, and all 3 of my businesses, I'd had a record-breaking month in business. I totally crushed it. And so interesting, this time, it was kind of weird because right before I decided to do this, this year business has been exploding. I mean, I've really been killing it. And the month prior, I'd had a record-breaking month in business. Before that was a record-breaking month. And so as a reward to myself, I decided to torture myself and do a 30-day challenge of getting up at 4 a.m., no masturbation, no alcohol, no TV or any of that. You know, what a great reward. But it has been, because I feel phenomenal. And as a result, again, I don't know why, But I've had a record-breaking month in business again in all three of my businesses. In my wedding business, my notary business, and my health and nutrition business, all three of them are exploding. In fact, so much that it's like I'm talking to my sister the other day and I was saying, you're still not enough hours in the day, even getting up at 4 a.m. because I'm crushing it. And I don't really know why that happens. I think it's just, and it's something that you will read, a great book to read if you want to start getting up earlier is called The Miracle Morning. I read that book. And I remember the author in that book, he talks about that. He became like the number one sales rep in Cutco, and he made it for his goal for himself to double his sales, which he was already number one. So to double when you're already number one is kind of like, you know, an extreme challenge and goal. But he decided to get up every single day, never skipping a day, every single day. And he called it the Miracle Morning, and he did. He doubled his sales and everything. And so for some reason, when you get up earlier in the morning, just great things tend to happen to you for some reason. I guess that's why they call it the Miracle Morning, because my businesses have just been exploding. I have felt an enormous amount of energy, and in fact, I have found doing this 4 a.m. challenge easier than when I did the 5 a.m. challenge, and I'm not really sure why. Maybe it's because I built up more willpower muscles from when I had completed that 5 a.m. challenge. But I felt more energy doing this. In fact, it's been really, you know, interesting. The overwhelming amount of energy that I've had has just been obscene. Like, I mean, it's just like, I constantly just feel like, you know, I'm blasting through the roof. Like, I'm running on very little sleep all the time, and I still feel incredible. Not breaking down, still feeling good. And so it's just, that in itself has just been really interesting and amazing. And there's a lot of things that I do in my whole morning routine. You know, if you leave a comment or something like that, let me know. I'll do a whole another video where I'll go into detail about exactly what I do on my morning rituals, my morning routine leading up to the day, because I think that's also an important part as well, is to have a morning ritual, to have a morning routine that you follow if you're going to do something like this, so that when you get up in the morning, you know exactly what you're going to do to have a head start on the day. And so on closing thoughts, again, you know, there's so much I have to talk about, but I know I can't talk all day. So on closing thoughts, just about, you know, why is it that I also didn't masturbate or watch TV or anything like that, or no alcohol? Well, I just kind of decided, I've done all those 30-day challenges before individually, but I thought, what would happen if I just did them all together? You know, that'd be pretty interesting. And take off an extra hour of sleep at the same time, get up at 4 a.m., that would be interesting. And one thing I've always found is when I go periods of time without, you know, any masturbation, that I have a tremendous amount of energy, that I crush it in the gym, that it's just ridiculous. And I can't speak for women, I have no idea, but for men, I have read about this, that it's kind of dates back to Asian philosophy and so forth, that they always saw it as like, they're kind of like their chi and stuff like that, that they protected their seed because they knew that that's how they could build up more energy, by preserving it. And so I thought, well, I'm going to be getting up at 4 a.m. I'm going to need the additional energy. And so that's something that I decided to add in. And not having TV, I think that helped to the productivity and increase my business, because, hey, I'm putting more time and effort into my business and staying focused and staying productive and reading. I've gone through a whole stack of books since I've done this. I've journaled every single day during this experiment, which I think is really important to document and to, you know, as you do any kind of experiment, that way you can reflect back and see what happened. That's kind of what motivated and inspired me to do this. I read back on what I did during my last 5 a.m. 30-day challenge, and I said, wow, you know, that was so incredible that, you know, I'll do it for 4 a.m. See what happens. You know, it's only 30 days. You know, a lot of people are like, oh my gosh. But, you know, don't stress yourself. 30 days is going to go by like that. This 30 days has gone by so fast. And I think about how much time goes by in our life. How many months goes by where you don't remember. You don't really remember, you know, what happened. I will never forget this 30-day experiment. I mean, I will never forget it. I have so many incredible memories from this 30-day challenge. Just like all the other 30-day challenges that I've done, I have so many incredible memories because of the extreme situations that I put myself through. When you force yourself to work hard, one thing I like about working hard is that it forces you to become present. It forces you to stay in the now. It forces you to really, where when you're high, when you're drunk, when you're lazy watching TV, you're checked out. You know, you may feel like you're relaxing and things like that, but you're checked out. And you're not really present to what's going on with you. You're not really collecting memories and experiences. Where when you do things to really push yourself hard, you're creating like a permanent memory in your mind. Like if you climbed like Mount Everest or something like that, you would never forget that. But I guarantee you, you won't remember all the millions of times that you've sat on the couch watching TV. And so you want to make your life more interesting, more fun, have more things to talk about. Do something like this. Do something extreme, you know, where you push yourself to do that. And so just leaving with two quotes, inspirational, motivational quotes that I think you guys appreciate. What my favorite quote of all time is from Steve Prefontaine, and he said, to give anything less than your best in this life is to sacrifice the gift. To give anything less than your best is to sacrifice the gift. And, you know, as you look back over the past year, just imagine if every single day you had committed to waking up earlier, like at 6 a.m. or 5 a.m. every single day. Just imagine what you could accomplish. You know, so to give anything less than your best, you're sacrificing. Another one of my favorites is that if today were the last day of your life, would you want to do what you were about to do? Steve Jobs said that. See, if you knew you only had 24 hours left, you know, literally 24 hours left, how long would you have slept? You know, how many hours of those 24 hours would you have wasted sleeping? Or would you literally milk every single minute of those 24 hours because you know it's going to be your last? I know for me, if I was like told, yep, you got 24 hours and it's done, you know, the story is over, I wouldn't even go to sleep at all. I would milk it for everything that it had. Why would you want to waste those 24 hours? And you have the rest of eternity to sleep. So with that being said, guys, please leave some comments, some feedback. Any questions you have or anything like that, I'll probably have to do a follow-up video on this experience as it's been, you know, very powerful. As you can tell, my brain's going a million miles an hour. So comments, feedbacks, and with that, guys, I wish you the best of luck and success on your journey. I hope to see you guys start waking up earlier. It doesn't have to be as extreme as getting up at 4 a.m., but even if it's just an hour earlier than you're used to, it could make a huge difference in your life. Peace.